Dads in the congregation, please be attentive to a few announcements as you are continuing to find your places and get settled in the pews. A new book club will meet at First Presbyterian next month. A new group is now forming to read and discuss some of the great books of recent publication. The First Presbyterian Book Club will meet monthly, 5 to 6 p.m. in the parlor on the third Thursday of each month. The first meeting will be 5 p.m. on July 18th. Please consult your bulletin for the name and author of the first book for discussion and call the office for more information if you need it. Vacation Bible School at First Presbyterian will be July 8, 9, and 10. From 9 a.m. to 12 p.m., bring children ages 7 to 12 for great fun, games, crafts, music, and Bible stories. Registration and activities will be in Fellowship Hall beginning at 8:30 a.m. on Monday, July 8th. To register online, please see today's bulletin for the online link. Also, mark Sunday, August 4th on your calendars. On that day, all Sunday school classes and others in the congregation will join together in a rally day program in Stratton Chapel beginning at 9 a.m. The rally day spirit will continue into the morning worship service at 10:30 a.m., where we will have blessings of backpacks and laptops and other electronic study aids. And after worship, we'll gather for a delicious meal in Fellowship Hall. Community prayer takes place in the prayer room located adjacent to the sanctuary every Monday at 11:30 a.m. This prayer time is informational and offers opportunity to pray with others for people and things that are on each person's heart. Join the pastor's Bible study on Tuesday, June 18th at 11 a.m. in the parlor in Stratton Chapel. You can also consult the bulletin for the scriptures for that. Attendance has been high during the past few months at the Natchez in Historic Photographs. Please consider donating a couple of hours to the museum as a docent. You will be a greeter, offering welcome and a few words about the church and the exhibit. The exhibit is open Monday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. You can call Rosemary Hall or the church office to sign up for that. Youth Summer Adventure Day for the FPC Youth Group will be Saturday, June 29th in Baton Rouge for a day that is sure to be packed with fun and excitement. The itinerary includes a visit to the Urban Air Trampoline Park, an escape room experience, and much more. To find out more or to register your student, please contact Reverend Caldwell or the church office. And finally, Wonderful Wednesdays. Come for Wonderful Wednesday food. For Wonderful Wednesday, food is at 5:15. Bible study led by Reverend Gandy begins at 6. And the sanctuary choir rehearses on Sundays at 9:45 a.m. through the month of July. After this month, Wednesday rehearsals will resume. Finally, the handbell choir is taking a summer break. Rehearsals will begin again in the fall. This concludes the announcements. Now, let us worship God.
Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We come together to worship God. May God bless us in this service to be true and to love one another as we express our love and praise for God in worship. May this be a blessing for everyone who's gathered this morning in the sanctuary, and a blessing for all who are gathering with us online as well. We've come to worship God. Let us begin. Will you join me, please, in the call to worship? In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of mountains, and it shall be raised up above the hills. People shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, so that he may teach us his ways and we may walk in his paths. For all the nations walk, each in the name of its God, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised." Let's stand and praise God in song. Please be seated. Let's begin with a prayer. Grant, O Lord Jesus, that the ears which have heard the voice of your songs may be closed to the voice of dispute. Grant, we pray, that the eyes, our eyes, which have seen your great love, may also behold your blessed hope. Grant that the tongues which will sing this morning your praise may always speak the truth in love. Grant that the feet that walk in your sanctuary today may walk always in the regions of light. And finally, O Lord, grant that the bodies which have received your living body may be restored in newness of life. Glory to you, Lord, for your inexpressible gift. Amen. As we turn to the Lord in a time of confession, we do so knowing that God is merciful. God will always hear us when we cry out that we know we need God in our life. Even when we try, we cannot be perfect. And so let us call first for God's presence to be with us. Please pray. God of life, there are days when the burdens we carry are heavy on our shoulders and weigh us down, when the road seems dreary and endless, the skies gray and threatening, when our lives have no music in them, and our hearts are lonely, and our souls have lost their courage. Flood the path with light. Turn our eyes to where the skies are full of promise. Tune our hearts to brave music. Give us the sense of comradeship with heroes and saints of every age. And so quicken our spirits that we may be able to encourage the souls of all who journey with us on the road of life. All to your honor and glory, in penitence and faith, let us confess our sin to Almighty God. Together, Holy and merciful God, we confess our sinfulness and our offenses against you. You alone know how often we have sinned. In wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love, have mercy on us, O Lord. For we are ashamed and sorry for all that we have done to displease you. Forgive our sins and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Friends, hear the good news. Who is in position to condemn us? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, and a new life has begun. Know that today you are forgiven in Jesus Christ. Be at peace. Amen. Let us stand to give glory to God.
Glory be to the Father.
As those forgiven through Jesus Christ, let us never fail to forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with all of you this morning.
And also with you.
And let us share peace with someone near.
Thank you.
something earlier today that belonged to you, didn't I? Do you know where it is?
Somewhere up here in the church, a little lamp. No, it's not in my hands. It's hiding somewhere over there. I'll give you a hint. It's kind of over by where this candlestick is. You see it? No good. Something can be hiding right in front of us and we can't see it. Well, you know, that's how God's presence in our lives is sometimes, isn't it? We can't hear God always with our ears. We can't see God always with our eyes. But does that mean God's not there? No, God is there. Jesus said the kingdom of God is like a little tiny seed that you almost can't see. Grows up, it's so big that all the birds of the air can nest in its branches, it becomes a giant tree. And so we want to walk by faith and not by sight. We look not just with the eyes of our head, but with the eyes of our heart. Not just the ears of our head, but the ears of our heart, so that we can always know and hear how God is among us. So be on the lookout. Walk by faith and not by sight, because God is always with us. Let's stand and say a prayer together. Dear God, thank you for the gift of faith. Thank you for your presence. Help us to hear you. Help us to see you. And give us faith to believe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, our God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, that we may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. A reading from 1 Samuel. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in Gibeah of Saul. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, but Samuel grieved over Saul, and the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he'll kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I named to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded, and he went to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, and they were trembling, and they said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. And when they came, he looked out on Eliab, and he thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see mortals the way mortals see mortals. They look on outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Adonab and made him pass before Samuel, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." The Lord has not chosen any of these. Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "Well, there remains yet the youngest, but he's keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send him and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and beautiful, had beautiful eyes, he was very handsome. And the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went back to Ramah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now a reading from Psalms. The Lord answer you in the day of trouble. The name of God, of the God of Jacob, protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and give you support from Zion. May he remember all your offerings and regard with favor your burnt sacrifices. May he grant you your heart's desire and fulfill all your plans. May we shout for joy over your victory, and in the name of our God, set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord will help his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with mighty victories by his right hand. Some take pride in chariots and some in horses, but our pride is in the name of the Lord our God. They will collapse and fall, but we shall rise and stand upright. Give victory to the King, O Lord. Answer us when we call. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And lastly, a reading from 2 Corinthians. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at the home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from his body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him, for all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Everything has become new. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for our second hymn.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The word of the Lord. Let us pray once more. Lord, you have the words of life. To whom else shall we go? Open your words, speak them, give us ears to hear them. We ask this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. He was wedged between the azalea bushes and the side of the house. You'd have to squeeze in front of past the rough bricks and make your way through poking branches just to catch a glimpse of him. The shadows cast by the eaves of the roof and the thick foliage made it the darkest place in the whole yard. It was the perfect hiding spot. He easily won the last round of hide-and-go-seek. He had disappeared. It wasn't until sometime later we gathered around the table to say the blessing that someone finally noticed he was gone. Where is Leroy? Before panic set in and a missing person report was filed, the grandkids suddenly remembered that we had failed to finish the game and find the last person. Someone stuck out their head through the door and said lunch was ready, and there came Pawpaw stumbling out of the azalea bushes, where he had successfully hidden for almost an hour. Isn't it strange? Losing something or being unable to find something, not to mention someone, is one of the most frustrating or even terrifying things that can happen to us. And yet for fun, we play games like hide and go seek, word searches, where's Waldo? Lose your phone, your wallet, your keys for more than 5 minutes, and you might start to feel like it is going to be a very bad day, but then you might spend hours searching for hidden treasures in a garage sale or antique store, chasing that elusive big buck or bass that could be hiding closer than ever. Seeking and finding, looking and searching for what is hidden, are some of the most basic functions of human beings. It's estimated that for about 90% of our history as a species, we were hunter-gatherers, living off of what we could find just over that hill, behind that rock or tree, across that field or river. To search for what is hidden, to seek and find, is, of course, also something that God made us for. In Acts 17, Paul is in Athens preaching to all sorts of searchers, Greek philosophers, worshipers of various gods. And Paul says, from one ancestor, God made all peoples to inhabit the earth. He allotted their times, the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps fumble about for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each of us. God longs for us to find him. God calls for us with all of our lives to search out, to look with all that we are, to seek to discover God's presence that is always nearer than we think. And yet God doesn't exactly make it easy, does God? God hides, we can even say. Now sure, God reveals God's self. In Jesus, the Son of God, God literally moved heaven and earth so that we could know this God. But even then, as God's presence and power was revealed in Jesus, it was also hidden. Mark writes in our gospel reading that Jesus would not speak to the crowds except in a parable. A parable conceals as it reveals. It's a riddle as much as it is a metaphor. The kingdom of God is like seed sown in a field, a mustard seed growing. The kingdom of God is like these things. But what exactly is this kingdom, Jesus? The crowds must have found themselves wondering. Again and again, God seems to favor the way of the parable over the more direct approach. God speaks God's word to us. That's why we're here, isn't it? And yet God hides God's word in an old book from a faraway time and place, hidden in languages almost nobody knows anymore, hidden in scriptures and stories that are not always easy to understand or follow. We often wonder, what exactly did God mean by that? And often we don't all agree, do we? By God's Spirit, God uses ordinary people to reveal God in the world. But have you ever met people? Calvin said it's as much a provision for our weakness as it is a test of our obedience that God has us listen to people that proclaim his word. Does this person really know anything about God, we might sometimes think? You might be having that very thought right now. It's strange, isn't it? God and God's ways are often hidden from us. At least they feel that way. We are asked to walk by faith, not by sight. Paul says in Jesus, we can see ourselves and each other a new creation, the old gone, everything become new. But we won't if we look only according to the flesh. If we only see Jesus or ourselves or others from a human point of view. On this side of heaven and the resurrection, God's new creation sneaks up on us. Or maybe sneaks right past us if we aren't looking. Even as God shows up in our world and our lives, God usually does so in such a way that's not exactly obvious. It could be missed, ignored, even doubted. That's how it went with Jesus. But just because something is hidden doesn't mean it's not there. The seed that the farmer scattered on the soil didn't disappear overnight, even though it's covered with dirt. The seed sprouts and grows even if a first century farmer doesn't understand how. At less than a tenth of an inch, the mustard seed is still there, even if you have to squint to see it. And soon enough, you won't be able to miss the 9-foot-tall tree of a weed that that tiny seed will become. If Jesus had been speaking to folks around here, he might have said, "The kingdom of God is like mushrooms. It grows most of the year unseen, its threads buried, invisible in the earth, the leaves, the soil, until a soaking thunderstorm comes, and the next morning they're everywhere you look, splashes of red and orange all through the woods, circles of white popping up in your front yard." Or maybe the kingdom of God is, bear with me, like an alligator. You see just a pair of eyes, the tip of a snout, the slightest little swish in the lake or the bayou, If you don't know any better, you might mistake it for an innocuous floating limb, a harmless turtle. But if you do know better, you pay close attention to where that thing is going. There's a whole lot more alligator beneath the water's surface than you can see. What would you give to learn to find what is hidden? What if you could learn to see the beauty in the world that is often missed, not because it's not there, but because we've so filled our lives with the fog of busyness and distraction? What would you give to be one of those people, maybe you know a few, who seem like they can actually hear God, tangibly feel God, somehow see and follow God? What if we could learn to more fully live for that kingdom that, although it is hidden, is far more real, far more powerful, far more eternal than all those kings and kingdoms we spend our lives worrying and obsessing over? What if you could really walk by faith and not by sight? The prophet Samuel did. He had learned to hear the unhearable and see the unseeable from that first night that God called him in the house of God as a boy. Later, when he ran across a young man named Saul, who of all things was out lost looking for his father's lost donkeys, he had the ears to hear God saying, "This inconspicuous man will be the ruler of my people who will deliver them." Samuel anointed Saul king. He did deliver God's people. And yes, they found the lost donkeys. And then later, despite all outward signs of Saul's success, victory over Israel's enemies, popularity and respect with the people, a massive army, Samuel had the eyes to see that Saul was not God's king anymore. Samuel heard that hidden voice calling him to go to a little place called Bethlehem, where he would find the new king among the sons of a man named Jesse. Samuel is a little more than nervous. Maybe he's even unsure of how this is all supposed to work out. That's often how it is when you walk by faith and not by sight. "Won't Saul see what I'm doing?" Samuel thinks. "Is this crazy enough to get me killed?" So God gives Samuel a cover. The hidden voice tells him to take a little cow with him and make a sacrifice for the village and Jesse's family as the reason that he's there. The townspeople of Bethlehem see Samuel coming just days after he's publicly denounced Saul as king, and it looks like trouble to them. The hidden new creation, the hidden kingdom of God, is often trouble for the old and obvious. The world as it is often pushes against the world as it should be. And so these people think, is Samuel coming to drum up support for an insurrection, a coup, a civil war? Samuel assures them, "I've come in peace, just making my rounds, doing regular old no change ministry," Samuel basically said with a wink. And that night, as Jesse's family gathers around the sacrifice, Samuel's eyes at first deceive him. The first son, Eliab, looks the part of a king to Samuel. But that hidden voice says, "No, not this one." And then the next son, "No, not this one." And the next, "No, no, 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 no." None of the seven sons of Jesse have the hidden hand resting on them. It turns out there's another son. He's not even in the picture as Samuel begins. He's off shepherding the sheep, as if God could make this hidden parable any more obvious. And when David, the almost forgotten son, shows up, the hidden hand points right at him and says, "This is the one." Samuel anoints little David then and there to be God's king. But other than Samuel and those gathered for the sacrifice that night, no one in Israel knows that anything is different. There's no crown, no palace, no army, no victory, no celebration. The only change anyone might can see, if they have the eyes to see it, is that from that day on, the hidden Spirit of God moves powerfully in David's life. If you can have the eyes to see it, that same unseen Holy Spirit is moving among us this morning. Right now, that same hidden hand reaches into your life. That hidden voice whispers into the ears of your heart. Seeds of the kingdom right among us are being scattered and sprouting. Just beneath the surface of our world, just beyond sight, new creation is coming. It's not obvious. It's mostly hidden. This love that compels us, this kingdom where all things will be made new, this heaven come to earth, we often fail to see it and hear it. We deny it. We doubt it. The first time around, we nailed it to a cross. Nowadays, we don't need a cross. We just scroll past it, don't we? We might not hear that silent voice for all the noise, the busyness, the worry, the constant hustling. We might have our hands so tight on our phones, our work, our wallets, our old life as it is that we cannot yet open them to clasp that hand that would lead us to life as it could be. Maybe, if you're honest, faith, Jesus, the whole thing is lost, hidden to you at the moment. Maybe at least a little. But you know that old dad joke about lost and hidden things? They're always in the last place that you look. That's where Rosemary's phone was. It's where Pam's charger always is, that is, in my desk. They didn't disappear. They haven't gone. There are those seeds scattered. There's that tiny weed of a mustard sprout. There's that mushroom, that alligator, right where you haven't looked yet. Here's that unspeakable, unfathomable love of God that calls and compels you. I think you can hear it. Maybe not perfectly. I think you can see it. Surely not completely. If you wait till it's obvious, you might be waiting till the donkeys come home. But wherever you are, wherever you've been searching, this can be the last place you look. Today you can believe anyway. We believe, don't we? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand now and say what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. As we turn to God in prayer, let us remember all of those whose names are on our hearts this morning. Let us remember those who are in trouble today, whose names we don't know, but those we want to pray for because we know the world is filled with such people. Let us turn to God in prayer for the world, for our own community, and for our own church, and for ourselves and our loved ones. Please bow in prayer. God, you are our Father and our Maker. You give us life. We know that in you there is no variation or shadow of change. Only you are the fount of every perfect gift. You, the source of every generous act of giving. You have adopted us as your children, placed your image within us, made us your royal priesthood. You, Lord, have called us out of darkness into your marvelous light, and it all has been the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. He comes to illuminate everyone and everything, to show us things we have not seen. When our earth is cloaked in darkness, and the sun seems not to shine on us, you always shine most brightly in him. O Christ, by your resurrection, you hold all things together, making peace by the blood of that cross. God, you are the giver of your Spirit as you give blessedly so much to us. You allow us to know things that we have not known. Lead us to serve with glad and generous hearts. You pour out power upon us as your followers. We ask your blessings as we turn to the world and look at all of the healing that it needs and the peace that must be made. We ask that you would be around it all and within it all, in the midst of it, bringing your love into every community that needs you. We ask that you would bless our country, bless those who lead us, bless this community and those who lead us in this place. And bless this church and churches all over our area and those who are leading the churches, those who are worshiping this morning. May their praise rise up as one to give glad thanks to you. Use us as we look around us and see people who are grieving, people who are imprisoned by their own lives, their own choices. Help us be those who can go and bring freedom, bring comfort, bring wholeness to those who need you this morning. We know of those who are nearing death. We ask that you would be near to bring your comforting assurance to them. Be with all of those who are anticipating treatment or surgery or loneliness or death in their midst. And let there be strength that only you can give. We depend upon you, O God. We want to be dependable as your people. Hear our prayers for the people everywhere and for people near who are in trouble this morning. And bless us as we deal with things that perhaps we've not said openly to anyone and may be holding in our hearts this morning. And in this moment of silence, Help us to let those prayers go to you now. And we ask, O God, that you hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come to a time of thanksgiving as we turn to God with gifts and tithes and offerings. Let us do so generously and always with joy. Let us pray in thanks together. Gracious Lord, we are so pleased to be able to bring these gifts to you. We ask that you would bless them. Thank you for the privilege of giving so that we might support the work of your kingdom. Let these gifts be used for those things you have in your will for us in this place. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing for the last hymn.
Thank you. to you, little flock. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.